I'm Chico. Actually, my name is Shimizu. That is very hard to pronounce English speaker, so please call me Chico. Chico is my another pronunciation, actually. But I'm here as a volunteer. Actually, I'm working at Mozilla Japan, and I'm a kind of developer relationship guy. So I have several talks. And my job is speaking technical things in front of developers. And actually, but today I'm here as a volunteer. Anyway, so before starting the workshop, can I take your photos from here? Does anybody care about who don't want to be taking pictures here? If you care, please raise your hand. I will try to avoid them. Okay, just for my report. Okay. Hey. Anyway, that's it. Okay, and so quick question: have you ever
working? Is it working?
Yes.
Okay. Have you ever written some Rust code before? Raise your hand. Okay. So have you ever been like some C code or C++ code? This
code.
Call
the microphone.
Okay. Okay, good. So most of them, have experience of writing, compiling a code. Okay, good. Actually, I have several experience of the workshop of last programming in Japan, but most of attendees from the JavaScript community, so they don't understand how to compile or something like that. Okay, but very nice environment to me. And here is today's goal. Today we have 2 hours, and first half we are overview of our last fundamental things, especially syntax things and the last two very troublesome feature like ownership, but ownership. And second half, we are going to implement some Unix, traditional Unix one, cat. It's a concatenate, actually showed in the concatenate, but it shows the content of text files if to the terminal that we are going to build, write the cat command with last. Just a second. And rest, if we have extra time for after writing, finish writing cat command very early, so please extend it by yourself. That is today's goal, contents I bring to you. And today's goal, my goal is, these things. Okay, here's my self-introduction, skip. And programming last, I heard that this is the second workshop, last meetup in Singapore, and so all of you may know what Rust is. But so give a brief summary. Rust is a programming language, actually. Originally, it is made from Mozilla. Actually, Mozilla supported huge support, but it's not Mozilla product, actually. And its characteristics its goal is more safety, more good improve C++ with more safe to write a safety program in easy way, and it's also it is a modern language, so its design is care about some multi processes. So it's easy to hand thread or something like that. And that is a brief summary of Rust. And here is Rust syntax is very affected by Ruby things. So we can write a list processing program like this. This is a example code which summation of our integer values contained in the actually it some accumulate all positive integer values contained in the list. So in the first one, in this line, B actually is a big array, a list, and we can make a filter out to say in give a field light filter with this kind of higher order function way. So we so Rust has a closure itself, and we can define the higher order function in the Rust. And we can sum all things and return its value as a result. But it is very hard to compile efficiently such kind of codes. But Rust compiler is very smart enough to expand such kind of higher order function to the more lighter way. So very efficient. That is a very interesting feature of Rust, actually. And so Rust, before starting up the workshop, we should check we need a compiler installation. Did you install the Rust compiler? Okay. So if we have a Wi-Fi connection, actually I know he has no Wi-Fi connection for us, but if we have some internet connectivity, we can try some Rust syntax here. It is an online execution environment, and we can write Rust code and run on the browser. So please write when you get back to home. Okay, so compile skipping. So let's start with hello world. So it's very boring thing, but it's a traditional thing. So we can start with the hello world. When we install Rust compiler, a command named cargo is also installed, which is a package manager of the Rust programming environment, like an npm for Node.js or bundle in Ruby or something like that, pip for the Python. And so we do not run Rust compiler directly, but we can compile run Rust program via by cargo command. So let's start. So could you open your terminal and put this command? Then we will get the hello world.
Okay. Cargo. Cargo is as I mentioned before, cargo is a package management system, but it also has a functionality to create a skeleton code or template for the Rust program. And we can create a new Rust program like this way. So it creates hello directory, a folder inside, and which contains these files inside. So we have one cargo term file, which is a list of a dependency list of the project. And SRC folder contains a main RS, it's an entry point. It contains a main entry point inside it. Yeah, actually it is a Rust command cargo create hello world command already. So we need to make a hello world, we need just all thing we should do is typing cargo command. And the cargo also build our Rust program by typing by this command. So which compiles Rust our program in debugging way, as a debugging release. So its compiled image is contained in this target for under placed on the under the target folder, and it's like this. So to run our hello world command, we just run cargo command with run command. So we get hello world here. Okay, so did you get it? Okay. So hello world here. So you have already so Rust
is last entry point is Rust's main function called the main. So all Rust program sequence starts with main function actually, and it's a resemble to similar to C or C++ actually, and here is a keyword of fn. Fn is a shortage of function, which means a defined function. Like, so it's a keyword to define the function. We put start with a fn keyword and the function name and list of arguments and the function body forwards. That's the basics. Last function definition, and we have another. We listed about we write a sick function body inside these brackets, and for now we have only one line inside the main function, which is a print name, of which name is a println. Actually, it is not a function, but it is similar to you can assume that it's a function call of the printn function, but it is not a function. It is a macro, so it compiler expand and it went before building this program. But it's for now we can from the higher level there's no difference between the function and the macro, so we can think for now we can think this is a function call. Okay. So let's speeding up. By the way, is this very too easy? Too fundamental? Is it okay? Okay. Let's move on to the variables. So variables is also similar to C way. How do we in C or C++? So we need to declare a function name before using it. Then, for example, in this line we declare one variable, each of which name is name, and it is it has a string value. Combined with a string value, and println macro, we can embed it the variable value in here like this way. So when we write the bracket like this, in this these brackets are embed the println macro will embed the variable this. Value of this variable here. Okay. And this is for now the last syntax is not so different from ordinary as a C-like programs, but here is a little bit difference. Actually, in other programming language. C-like programming language equal means assignment of the, which means variables have own memory space or have sub area on the memory, and assignment means writing a value into the its memory space. But in Rust, it is a little bit different. Value exists first, and then we name its value with equal, symbolic equal. So we call in Rust this first line, that we call this first line as variable binding. So it is a literally different concept. It's similar to the assignment, but totally different concept in the programming theory, as a theory. So, and here is a most one first last characteristic. All values in Rust is are immutable. We cannot make a reassignment like this way. So this program calls a compiler error.
But so let me see. So we try to, okay. Okay. So this program does not cause the compiler error, because we declare one variable and it bind to the this text and use text in the printed function, so that so we can compile and run this program like this. But in other programming languages, we can do such kind of things. That we can write such this kind of code, and we anticipate that this will also run well. So we will expect that this program, when we get two lines, hello Chico and hello Shimizu, in the will be printed to the console. But the reality is totally different, because it causes this kind of compiler error. So this is because the assignment is occurred,
because you know, but actually all Rust values are immutable. So when like we write this kind of code, that means mutable, how they put the modify the program a value assigned to the a variable. So that is that will be violate some cause some bugs in the program. So the Rust strictly prohibit this kind of code.
So
but we would like to do these kind of things. So we have two options. Where to do that, we have two options. First option is very simple. We make different another bindings by this. So we can, in other C like programming language, we cannot use this kind of code. We cannot write this kind of code,
because you know,
in other programming languages, this code is the declaration of the same variables. But in Rust, it is treated as a different way. So it is I say making another bindings which have a same name, eventually same name. So it is totally, how to say, so inside Rust, this program is treated like this way. But we can do like We can write this way. So for now we get expected result. Well, that is a very troublesome feature from of the last. And the second option to write this kind of code is make values mutable, declare variable as mutable. So we can declare variable name to, we can make variable mute a name mutable by using this this kind of declaration with key with mute keyword. With this keyword we can make this value is mutable, so this code does not occur, causes compile error. Okay, that is a Rust characteristics. So mutability is mutable variables causes some bugs, so we use carefully this kind of keyword. But also actually mutable variables causes some very difficult situation. Cause more serious compile error, like for example we pass this value to the function as a variable argument or make some other value from this kind of mutable variables. So we have two options. Mutable is very effective or very easy to understand for C programmers, but you need to be careful about it, how to use it. Okay, so that is a variable. So we have, when we declare variables, we have to think about name and which it is mutable or immutable. We should think about two things, actually. And here's a function. So let's move on to the function declarations. It is similar to the C functions, but last is affected by functional programming languages. So its function signature is like this. So here is this is a list of arguments. So this function has two arguments of each every value of this function gets two integer values as an argument, and also this is a notation of that return value types. So that means that this add function gets two integer values and returns the integer values. Okay. And the function function's return value is the last compiler treats the last expression. Evaluated value of the last expression as a return value, function's return value. So this a plus b is the last expression in this function. So that means this evaluated value of this expression is a return value of this function. So please, you need to see this program carefully. So this line does not end with a semicolon or something like that. So you do not put a semicolon after this expression, because last compiler, if you put the last I would give some demo for that.
So we can write a function like this way. And so this program does not causes any compile errors. Oops. So okay. Yeah. Run correctly as we expected. But if you put semicolon after this line like this, it is very natural for C programmers. But when we do that, that will cause compile error, type error actually. Because you know, Rust compiler treat this semicolon as terminate of the expression that Rust compiler expect. There is another expression follows here. So and we have no expression here. So that means there is a blank expression here. So that and the last compiler think this function returns null value. And but the signature in signature this function is returns integer value. So there is a contradiction between the implementation and the signature. So that's the reason why this kind of the compile error. So be careful about how to use semicolons. Okay.
Okay. One question. Can you go back again to function? Let's say the add function definition is after main, right? I know in C you have to put a function prototype at the top. Do you have to do that for us?
Yeah, last is how to say prep. Prep. Actually, last prep the this function definition. So you can write function up top before they use it or after. So that is only my how to say my custom or custom actually. Yeah, I'm familiar with this kind of lighting. Okay. Okay, so and the last compiler has a strong type inference functionality. So there, in most cases, we does not need to annotate variable types, but we can do that like this way. But how to say type notation of string is very difficult to. But so like this way. Yep, like this way. Okay, good. And here is a list of last primitive types. So we have Boolean value types and character values. Character is different from the as a C character in C or C++, because its bandwidth is totally different. In C, it character is a 8-bit with this bandwidth, but in Rust it represents a Unicode character, so it is 4 bytes. I believe, and we have several integer types like this. This number means its size, so which means I32 means integer value with 32 bit size, like this. And U means unsigned, I means assigned integer, and we also two floating point types, and we have three string types. Actually, this is a static string. Is a how to say static string, which is allocated in the data segment, so we cannot modify its value. Yeah, and str is actually the slice.
which str is represents some range between the strings. So we have long if when we have substring, we can substrings are represented as with these kind of types. And a string type means is a type like a string buffer in Java. So we can which has a memory area, allocated memory, then we can use string this value use as a buffer. So to manipulate strings text, we will use this. Yeah.
Question. So does the static thing generalize to other types? Like, for example, can I have like a static array of 8-bit unsigned numbers or something?
No. Yeah. No. Actually, it is string is a kind of a vector, or this represented as implemented as a list vector. But in Rust program, this vector, in ordinary vector, and this string is totally different things. Because string this type implements some different methods which does not vector have. So that's the reason why. And I'm sure there's no other types. So we can write the list or arrays static, like in the static way, but does not allocated in data segment. It will be allocated in the stacks.
So in the upcoming AVR backend, like this is not going to be usable for like flash stored program stuff. Like that, you need some kind of other annotation. Like if you have a Harvard architecture and you have data program, then this doesn't give you a ready-made solution.
We can link Rust program with C programs. So if you do that, if you want to do that, you write that these things in C or C++ as a C code and link them to the Rust code. It's just unsafe things. But there must be more, good way, but I'm sure. Okay, let's move on to the arrays. So we can write array leader like this, and the array is an array, not a list. So array has a fixed size. We cannot change its size. If you want to change arrays like things like size, you should use a vector, which is a list. So we can use the array in array ways, and we can get the length, array's length with this function like this. Array has a method which name is the len, which returns all array's lengths. Yep.
Is that evaluated at compile time? Because the type already has the length. Is there any code generated from this, or is it just three?
Replaced a fixed value when compiled. It is operated as a function call, actually. Method is implemented as a function, and of which first argument is object is saved. So give us a context. So that is a reason. Okay. And slice. And slice is means let's say range of the list or arrays. So we can make we can refer to these or sub arrays or substrings is a slice. So we can make a sub array which contains these from new array like this. So which contains this area to this element, and this element. So which contains that array like this. From the last program, from the viewpoint last program, there's no difference between the slice and the array itself. But in the compiled code, it is the difference of the slice is implemented as with a pointer, so there's no memory consumption. That means when we create a new slice, but it does not mean the memory copy or something like that. Last we have another the type which is which name is a tuple, which is a combination of values. Like so, we can use create define tuple with this like this. Okay. So wrap up. Hi. Yep.
So what's the difference between a tuple and a
tuple? One big difference is tuple contains several different types inside there as a member, and access how to access is different. Each access to each member is different to the array, and tuple is used as a could define a temporal structure, data structure. Okay, let's move on to the control flow. Last have several control flow expressions. First one is a conditional branch is described with if expressions. Actually, it is expression, not statement. So if we can write a code like this. So if has a evaluated variation value. So this means why will we bind it to the value 1 because x is greater than 0. So if x is binded to the value like minus 1, why will it bind to 0 like this? And loops, infinite loop can be described with loop statement. It is a statement actually, and we can also use while statement as well. And the for statement is not for we cannot use for statement for this defined to describing loops, because for statement is a scan is means a scan of iterators. And we can define simple. If we want to count up a value from 0 to 10, we can write such code will be like in this way. So in this section, we define a sequence. Actually, define an iterator which contains a value of 0 to 10, and we can scan for each item in that iterator with this program. And iterator can be translated to the enumerators. Enumerator means enumerator is an iterator with index value. And so we create in this section we create an iterator and by calling enumerate method of it over it, the iterator will be changed to the enumerator, and each item of the enumerator is consists of the is a tuple of which have two elements inside it. First element is a index over index over item, and the second one is a value of the over element. Okay. And here are the last things of the set or thing list data type. It is a vector. It's a list, actually. So we can define the vector with this macro, and we can scan vector with for operator or something like that. Like this, yeah, scanning a vector. We can write scanning scanning code like in various ways, but with enumerator we can say, for example, vector have several methods, and vectors iter method, by calling this method, the vector changes to the generate, create a new iterator, and which returns the enumerator. Okay. Anyway, maika. Soka. Ja, let's move on to the. Okay. So I can see all of you are feel boring to about to my explanation. So let's move more hands on. Let's write a new code about this. So here is a skeleton code. So let's move. Could you implement this function? Which and implement function. So foo is a function returns as which summarize or add all values and return over the every item inside given vectors. So we foo have two vectors as an argument. So you need to add all values inside this vector, and also add this bit element in the B2. So let's visualize it.
Return type.
I totally forget about it. Return type is will be integer.
Skeleton code.
So, could you create a new project for this exercise and implement it?
Okay.
どうしようかね。うんうんうん、なるほど。パターンを持ってこいって書いてる。って書いたんだっけ、これ。よいしょ。なんて書いてんだっけな。僕も忘れているぞ。ここでいいのかな。お、なんか言った。うん。
So lighting, when we light C-way, C-like code, it will be this kind of code. It is a one example of implementation. We can light more functional programming way, like with a fold method or something like map method or something like that. But this is a basic Rust code. I say C programmer familiar will be familiar with writing this kind of code.
Yep.
Is
there a difference between doing for I and D1 and doing for I
D1 later? So different between these two lines?
Yeah,
very different. Hmm. It is. It is actually it is different. Yeah, it is different. But this for statement means scanning over the iterator, which is generated from V1. But second one is scanning over the V2. That is totally little bit different because this when we call this method, V1 does not have the ownership over the vector's value elements, but vector actually implements aspect of the iterator's features. So that's the reason why we can do write this kind of code.
Yeah. I just tried it, and for example, you can't fold over the vector. You need to turn it into an iterator if you want to fold.
Oh, because
fold is a method of an iterator. I mean,
yeah.
Or something, and you have to be an iterator, not.
Yeah.
Do Rust have a shortcut for the result?
This line?
You need to add a type to the variable to be able to do that.
Yeah, actually, yeah. This is how I say this. Lastly, that's treat operators as a function call or something like function call, and this value type does not implement this function, so we cannot write this way. Yep.
And you're saying when you define result in your statement, let result equals to zero.
Mm.
Specify colon type and then write. The first line, let new result.
Mm.
So let new result colon space
item. Yep.
So you can
mute.
Hmm? Type,
because you know last comparer infers the type by other operation.
Yeah.
So
if you continue that, then you can do it. If you put the type in, it will just
like this way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You might compile, try to compile.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm.
Yeah, difference. Yep.
So does that mean that in the previous version, the one that which was result equals result plus I, right?
Yep.
In that version, does that mean that it implicitly dereferences I? Because you know, if you write result plus equals deref I, then it works. It kind of makes sense because I is not really a value, right? It's a pointer, I guess, or reference to value. But when you write it as formula,
I'll say. なんて言えばいいんだろうな。なんて言えば、reference。
So if you deref I first, right?
Yeah. Reference? Yeah, get confused with the situation, but.難しいな。なぜだ。OK. そうか。Yep. So, because, you know,、because this I is a reference to this each element this, inside this iterator. So, it is notated as a reference. So, that is a pointer. And, but this method expects the argument is a value, integer value. So, we can...
For example, this code can be this code will does not cause compile error. Maybe. Yep. But this I doesn't actually we expected I anticipate I is a integer value itself, but actually it is a pointer. So.That's the reason why compare that.
I think it's quite clear to everyone why this doesn't work and how to fix it. Yeah, but the real question is why does the other one work? Why does it work when you write it just without plus I? Because you're still adding a pointer know, like in the other one, in the second one.
Second one?
Yeah, in that one. Why does that work?
I'm not sure actual reason, but I assume that this operator has a different many type say implementation, like so actually which contains when we internally it is a defined as a integer value, and which is treated translated as a function call of which argument will be type is first argument is an integer value and first second value is a reference to the integer, and so this function and this function is different thing. So that's this reason why this second code works well. I assume that. Okay. Very complicated. Anyway, we can reference. Last has a reference value, actually. Difference, and we can reference by putting asterisk before the values. It's a C way. So, I have talked about we moved on to the another topic. It is ownership. Actually, Rust has ownership. Actually, Rust has a ownership is a very complicated things because you know Rust because this program this code calls compile error. Actually, so the reason. Is a weak that the reason is actually this by at the first line variable boy is binded to the a vector we call this vector, but in the third line the V2 is also assigned to actually binded to the this vector, but actually in this subline means V1 no longer owns actually no longer binded to the this value.
Let's see. ちょっとやってみよう. I will do my demo. こう例えば、よいしょ。 これだと良くないんだな。 どうしようかな。 This code works well, as our expectation. But this code can't be compiled because in compile error. Because you know, values can't be binded only one variables, so we cannot make association between two variables to the all same values, actually, because that idea we call ownership, like these kind of ideas, actually. So ownership is very complicated because it consists in some because ownership transfer occurs when we call functions. Actually, we can specify we can give a specify a call function like this, some function called v2. But it means the ownership over this value is transferred to the function's variable in the function argument. So v1 have no longer holds the ownership. V2 does not no longer connected have association between this value. So if we do this kind of that. Type inference is preprint. Yep. Yeah, that will be call this kind of compile error because you know value no is moved here to and moved to the this variable and V2 does not hold no longer hold contain holds this reference to the actual reference and have the ownership over this object. So to avoid this kind of compile error, we have two options. First one is we need to return the argument value with a return value with tuple, using tuple. So
コンパイラーが起きる。
First assignment.
なんだ?
おお、そうか。 ここで起きてるんだね。
あ、そうすか。こうだね。
はいはい。 これでいいのか? はい。 OK. So when we return the value to the as a return value, we can avoid such kind of compile error. But also, second option is we can use we can declare this argument as a reference. Reference mean so reference like this. So and we can when we declare this function like. In this way, so that means that when we call this function, and so function the ownership, is temporarily moved to the to the argument, and returns ownership automatically returns when the function is finished.
That's the basic idea. Okay. And here's some okay. That's the basic idea of ownership. Actually. Okay. So wrap up. Last assignment, actually, binding in last is very complicated. It is not assignment actually, and it is how to say ownership transfer actually. So when we should how to say we will suffer this kind of trouble very well. But that is last. Anyway, about the actually I consumed 1 hour already, so let's move on to the hands-on implementation of cat command. So let's start with creating a new project directory with cargo command. Could you create a new project directory for cat command and implement it and write its main program like this? We can get for argument, command line argument with as a vector in like this by calling this method. Actually, env is a namespace, and args function returns an iterator of the command line argument, and the correct method convert iterator into the vector. So by calling this method chain, we can get the vector of the command line argument, and it will be binded to this variable. Could you do that?
Okay. Mm-hmm. てしたんだっけ。確かタイプ失敗してる臭いの別な。X ストリングか。どうしないとダメか。OK。So
writing the first line we get the command line argument vector which contains the command line argument, and we can say detect its length, and we can change a switch control flow like in according to the depends on the arguments or argument is specified or not
in this way. But we can give a command line argument by via cargo command like this way. Okay. So now we can get command line argument. So let's move on to next things that is leading file. So to read files, we should import some functions into the namespace, so which is belong to the I/O namespace, and by like these three lines, we can call functions to manage or access files like by this function, and in last we can use files in C way. So we get the file descriptor. Actually, file descriptor by calling this method open method, and we get read whole contents as a string by this line, and we have new syntax here. Try it. That is
どこまで行ったんだろうね。消えちゃった。
Try. As you know, file access can be failed. So try is a macro which continue if when the its argument the value is is a success actually try macro terminates this function when file when we this function call fails. We cannot open the file this file, so that terminates this function here. Returned immediately here. And in last week, our error is 100 with result type, which consists of two values. First one is OK. Second is error. OK represents success case. Error represents the error case, and by using match, it is a pattern match statement. Combination of this result type and the pattern match, we can branch our control flow according to the some operations failure or success. In this way, so. First, could you write these lines add these four lines to your main program?
Question.
Yeah.
So does that call to clone mean that we are copying the?
Yeah, copy is a string.
But by like byte by byte, I mean it's a real copy. It's
yeah,
it's just a reference to the same.
Yeah, it's actually real copy.
Is it like a deep cloning or a shallow cloning?
Because, you know, because actually I define this function by let's just give a different get a different but there is an actual value get in this way, so that's why I'm cloning a string here to avoid some trouble in the of the cause with from the ownership problem. Yeah, we can change, we can write this, this line like this. By using reference, we can change when we declare this function this way like this, we can we do not need to clone make a copy of a string, but so this function gets a reference to the string. It is a different. When we remove the signature from ampersand from the its type annotation, that means that this function gets a string value. So that is a different. And in this case, we can this argus does no longer how to say and in the and in this case, and we call this function without copying a string value. So this argus variable does not contain the how to say the first element of the command line argument. So to avoid the trouble, I put this. I made a copy. Oh wait. Okay. And after writing that, could you implement the read file function like this? Thank you. And now we have implemented simplest cat command now. So read file function implements returns a file's content as content of a file content of a specified the file which is specified as a as an argument, and this file name comes from the command line argument of the when we call the function, and in this way, and reading as you know, reading files can be failed, and this program shows the file content only when each reading file success. In error case, it shows a stuck trace. Why is that this reading file is failed by this command?
For example, there is no file of which name is who here, so that will be failed. Here.
Yep. And in last, we can error handling is done. We will use this result type for error handling errors. Which consists of two things: two values, okay and error, and each of them have a payload. Okay contains some result of some tasks. Error contains the reason why its task fails. So, and we can, detect this task failed or success by with a pattern matching its return value with this match statement.
That's the basic idea of Rust pattern error handling.
And. Yep.
Oh, okay. One question, please. So, because you talked about the panic and the backtrace, what program do you use to debug like Rust programs, like for C++ or C? I have GDB.
Yeah.
Or LLDB.
We can use ZDB.
We can use
ZDB. Okay. But actually, Rust program doesn't need debugging when we pass the compilers, because you know that's many bugs can be found by compilers. It's very rare to use debuggers actually.
Right.
But then when we'd like to debug the program, that we can use GDB. Yeah, GDB.
If you compile, there's a debug field, I guess.
Yeah, it's very good. Yeah.
Okay, interesting.
So we would like to build to a release build, so no, without no debug symbols, we can specify the release.
Okay.
Yeah, so that command will be create a release build.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can do this.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So that is the basic. Okay. Very quick thing is that my content is over. So could you expand? After we have 30 minutes till 9 p.m. So could you expand yourself by yourself the current cat command?
そ
っか、Wi-Fi がないからな。Yeah. By the way, this slide is, how to say, published on the GitHub pages, so you can see. Yeah, sure. Actually, sure. How to say, it is very hard without. I'll see. Okay. Yeah, I should post it. And it repository consists of contains sample codes inside it.
This one use cargo, right? But then initial
tutorial, we use Rust C. Yeah, we can.
So it's just running based on the package manager. Right?
Yeah. Yeah, see that. I see that is that is easy to me. So, yeah, that's the reason, main reason. And as long as I depending from my experience, I have no. It is there to call. Use Rust C directory. Yeah, almost thing can be done with cargo command. Okay. Three. どうしよう。
You want the audience to do the like side, right?
Yeah. Okay. Okay. なんでだろう。え、なんでこれがエラーになるの。なんでこれがエラーになるんだろう。Anyway, so everyone doing half of them doing something.
どうしようか。
思い出した、そうか。そうか。おお、そうか、どうしようかな。スライスを作らなきゃいけない、スライスを作るのはどうするんだっけ。自分で。
I'm happy with this slide.
but actually Rust is a very comprehensive update. Rust have a trouble in the learning curve. Actually, it is tough to learn for C programmers. Rust is the easy learning tool for the system programmers, the functional programmers. So that really easier to C programmers, please. So please use my slide. And actually, my slide is published on the GitHub, so feel free to pull a copy it and feel free to send me a previous to improve your system. Okay, that's it.
Thank you.
Thanks for your